They personalize things. Like now, if we're going to the convention and the convention we have no table budget, that leader should not even stand again. That is failure. You needed to get yourself a successful play, okay? And you had the chance and you're not doing it. You know, you've been given the chance. None of your executive members is getting yourself ready to help you get the success. It should be a success on your part because you are the president or you're the leader of this organization. So these are the things that we are trying to put into the constitution now is looking at all those gray areas which we didn't have initially. And the fines and penalties are coming out for each leader so that each leader starts to be answerable for their position. Other than that, we would still go back to the same ways because there's nothing. There's no repercussions for what is going on in UNA. You just say, I am the CEO. I can do as I wish. And yeah, you can because you're the CEO. You don't care about us. And that's exactly what is happening in our UNA today.
Awesome. Thank you. Vice President.
Thank you so much. I want to piggyback on what our next executive secretary just mentioned. Pretty much we have what's called a 10-point program, which is a social contract with our team unity with UNA members. It has nothing to do with anybody else but the UNA members. We are going to serve our members. Our main theme out there is to clean house, and I'm glad you mentioned that. Why do I say that? Just like Madam Speaker was talking about, that you realize these organs, we have like different organs, the BOT, the Constitutional Review Committee, the Disciplinary Committee, the Executive, the Council, that they are people, to me in UNA, I realize they're clusters of people who think they own UNA. And UNA is supposed to be for the members. So we are coming as a team to say UNA belongs to UNA members. It does not belong to anybody else. So we want to bring the power back to the people, and that is cleaning house. What happens, the executive actually creates the BOT. The BOT creates the Electoral Commission. Sorry, I even forgot that. Because now it's the most important organ right now, since we're in elections.
It is their time.
It is their time to shine. And we're actually going to hold the Electoral Commission accountable. Mm-hmm. We all know what happened in Chicago mm-hmm. in 2019. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We want Ugandans in the diaspora to hold the Electoral Commission accountable. Yes, you've held Lydia Natol as the vice president accountable for the man apparently that went back to Uganda without even my hand making that possible, but rather a failed system that made that possible. And again, I can also take accountability to say maybe I failed somehow, somewhere, but my peers, no, there was a failed system. One of the major guidelines that was put into that was to make sure that these organizations that we're serving and the affiliate organizations, which are the cultural organizations, the local organization had to have 15 members. The affiliates had to have 10, just 10 members. I had presidents call me and they used to beg me that they cannot sign members because we need members in good standing, right? Mm-hmm. So how can I be holding phone calls for 10, 20 leaders trying to sign their members? There's a time there was somewhere, about 30 of them. They could not. And these are some of the things we told the secretariat. What is going on with the website? I'm sure there are so many members who have failed to register. I was in Chicago, pretty much sending a link to somebody. I'm like, please, here is the link. And they're like, but I can't. And then you stand next to them because it's their credit card they're using, it's their name, you know, and it's their information. And you're like, okay, go here, go there. Just like, as you know, some of our people, there's a notion of, it's not saying they don't know how to navigate, the system itself.
And you have to diversify to make it accommodative.
You have to. Make it simple.
Yeah.
It's black and white. People can easily just click. There's so many people who hold conventions for 10,000 people. Mm-hmm. I've been on those conventions. You pretty much, it's just 2 seconds and you've signed up. These are 10,000 people. UNA only gets about, in Chicago we had about 1,200 people?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So how can you fail to register 500 people with all this even COVID reality? We even begged and lobbied to make sure we have an online voting, because we know our people have lost their members to COVID. Our members are in hospitals. Most our members have just had newborn babies. How can you expect them to travel to Cincinnati
and the Delta variant
to be in a hotel? You know, with the little medical knowledge I have, we have a new variant, the Delta from India, and it's bad. It's even worse. This even affects young children. The one we had before, the children were spared. But now everybody is literally at an alert, and that failed too. So those are some of the failures. And again, when you go in a board meeting and you only have one vote, you're the only one voting to say, no, this is not right. But then the rest vote and say, no, this is right. We live in a democratic world, right?
You have to let it go.
I wanted the convention to go back to San Francisco. Mm-hmm. I was the only person who said, we are not going to another state, because it's the executive that makes these decisions. But again, why did we end up in Cincinnati? When our members, they had a community team, a local team, organizing a convention. And all of a sudden, we just dropped them like a bad habit. And we took a convention to another state. So those are some of the things we've realized in UNA, and saying, this is not going to be a personal decision. We actually need to take the decision to the members in the community. Mm-hmm. Where do you want to have a convention? Mm-hmm. Let us have a poll. Why is just 4 or 5 people making a decision where the convention has to be?
You are watching AI TV. AI TV, connecting the diaspora.